Hi, my name is Patrick Boyle. Welcome back to my YouTube channel, where we're learning all about derivatives and quantitative finance. If this is the first video you're watching, make sure you click on the subscribe button to see more content like this. I've just done a series of videos explaining what value at risk is, and this one is the last on that topic. By the end of this video, you'll understand expected shortfall and stress testing and how they're used by risk managers. Expected shortfall, which is also known as conditional value at risk, or CVaR, is related to VAR, but is maybe a little bit more conservative. Expected shortfall calculates the average of the losses in the worst X percent of cases. VAR might tell you that a loss of $1 million or greater is a VAR 99% break. Expected shortfall would then calculate the average return of all of those worst 1% of days. The expected shortfall figure at a given confidence level will always be a larger negative number than VAR at that confidence level. In addition to calculating VAR, financial institutions will also carry out stress testing. Now, stress testing is a big part of risk management, and most traders will build their own stress tests simply to understand the risks on their books and kind of how bad things can get. So what does stress testing involve? Well, it involves testing how a portfolio would have performed in extreme market conditions. Now, there's a few ways of doing this. One would be just to describe a stressful market condition. So we'll say, for example, if you looked at how your portfolio would perform if the stock market fell by, we'll say, 10% and implied volatility tripled in a day. That's one way of doing it. You can come up with all sorts of stressful scenarios to test how your portfolio performs in them. Another approach is to look at actual real events and see how your portfolio would have held up during those events. So we'll say, for example, events like the 1987 crash, September 11, 2001, or during the worst days of the financial crisis of 2007-2008. So that's what stress testing is. And then on top of that, there's stressed VAR, or SVAR, which is a measure of market risk tailored to stressed market conditions. This measure incorporates scenario analysis in a standard VAR setting. So in wrapping up this series of videos on value at risk, I'd like to point out that successful risk management is very much in the details. While there's a lot of useful formulas out there to help the risk manager, and we've gone through a lot of those in this series, the subjective component of risk management is significant. A good risk manager at a financial institution spends a lot of time out on the trading floor talking to the traders and trying to understand what they do and how they think about risk and what kind of risks they're willing to take and they're unwilling to take. And so once a risk manager understands the engine that generates the firm's profits, they'll be much more capable as a risk manager rather than someone who just runs quantitative screens on a spreadsheet and goes around the floor telling people that their VAR is too high. That's often not the most useful form of risk management. A good risk manager is going to understand the true risks that the firm or the portfolio is exposed to. So a line that always amused me is a well-known hedge fund manager, David Einhorn, has compared VAR to an airbag that works all of the time except when you have a car accident. And there's a certain amount of truth to that. You know, as I explained in my earlier videos about VAR, it's telling you what a normal bad day or an average bad day looks like, but that doesn't necessarily inform you very much as to how horrible things can get or how crazy the market can get. Now, while VAR does have many flaws, it does still add some value as a tool of risk management. Like all of the formulas that we do use in quantitative finance, VAR does suffer from the garbage in, garbage out problem. And I've kind of mentioned that probably in every video that I've done that explains a formula. In quantitative finance, we do use a lot of formulas, and when you're a beginner, they can seem super exciting because these formulas, they're often derived from places like physics or engineering. And to those who don't really know any better, they seem to give rock solid answers. They'll tell you the perfect price for a given option or the exact amount of risk on the books. But in finance, unlike in physics or engineering, most of the inputs are predictions, rough estimates, or numbers that for a variety of reasons can change very quickly. So the formulas that we use help us to compare value or help to give us a way of understanding the risk on the books today compared to the risks on the books last month. Financial mathematics is extremely useful, and I've made a career in quantitative finance, so I'm by no means knocking the usefulness of these formulas. It's extremely useful to an investor or a risk manager who always keeps in mind the assumptions that are underlying the various formulas, and someone who is aware of how these things can go wrong. So I've always argued that a student of finance and risk management needs to spend some time studying financial history. In fact, when I teach my class on financial derivatives at King's College London, I devote one whole class to discussing examples of financial derivatives disasters and what we can learn from them. While every financial crisis is different, important lessons can be learned from the past. All of these videos are based on my book, which is called Trading and Pricing Financial Derivatives, which is available on Amazon, and there is a link below. Hit the like button to let me know if you found this video helpful, and hit the subscribe button and the bell button next to it in order to see more videos like this in your feed. The bell button just sends you a notification when a new video is out. The subscribe button just kind of puts this type of video in your feed. Anyhow, have a great day and see you next week. Bye.